Thank you for tuning in to Voice of Reason Boston. My name is Tamisha Civil, your host. And today we have our wonderful guest. His name is Ted Phillips. Ted Phillips just won the primaries for the 8th Norfolk District. We're going to get to know Ted today. And we're also going to be talking about the experiencing of campaigning while COVID. Or campaigning during COVID. We know this is a trying time for everyone, and also for those who are running for office to try to make a change in their community. So we want to say thank you, Ted, once again, for coming on the show today and just talking about your experience and what your goal is going forward. And again, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
No problem at all. So, Ted, if we can get to know who you are, can you give us a little bit of background of Ted Phillips and, you know, your where you live and who you are?
Sure. Well, I am a Sharon kid. You know, I grew up in Sharon, Massachusetts. We actually moved here when I was 3 months old, so I don't get the townie status that everybody talks about. Been pretty much lived here for my whole life. I graduated Sharon High School in 2001, and I basically got bitten by the political bug when I was back in high school. I ran for student council, and I loved being a part of my student government there. So I sort of thought public service might be for me. I then started watching The West Wing almost religiously. And that's when I was like, this is it. This is what I want to do with my life. So I went to UMass Amherst. I graduated 2005. When I graduated, a friend of mine who had worked in the Massachusetts State House, had interned for a state senator actually from central Massachusetts, tipped me off to a job opening that was occurring there at the time. I put my name in and got to work for that senator. It was a guy named Steve Brewer from central Massachusetts. And I worked for the 29 cities and towns in between, basically between Worcester and Amherst. And I did constituent services for a year. And then when that year was up, Representative Lou Kafka, who is the current representative for the 8th Norfolk District, he came to me because he had an opening in his office and said, listen, you know the district, you're from Sharon, you understand, you know, all the issues that are facing us locally. I want you to come work for me. So I switched from the Senate to the House. And then I've been working for Representative Kafka for the last almost 15 years. It'll be 15 years in November. And this year, Representative Kafka decided that he was not going to run again, that he was going to retire rather than seek re-election. And so I threw my name in, and here I am as the Democratic nominee for state representative.
Yes, you are. And can you tell me the districts you're representing?
Sure thing. The 8th Norfolk District, it's a strange little district. It's all of Sharon. It is half of Stoughton. And then two precincts in Walpole and one precinct in Mansfield. It's a funky-shaped district. Most of it is in Norfolk County. The one precinct in Mansfield is in Bristol County.
And I know you said you had political experience for a long time. And given the things that are happening in our country right now, what pushed you to say that, you know what, this will be the year that I'm going to go and run and try to make an impact in my community?
You know, I had always felt like as a staffer in the building, as a staffer for, you know, again, first in the Senate, then in the House, I had felt like I did a pretty good job, in terms of helping people, doing constituent services. Working on legislation that was inspired by constituent problems, people who would come to us and say, you know, I have a problem with the state. This is, you know, this isn't working for me. We need to change the law so that it works better for everyone. Those sort of experiences have always driven me in my career. Those are the most rewarding experience when you can make that sort of positive impact on people's lives. The legislation that we passed when I was working for Representative Kafka, it wasn't sort of like the big overarching legislation that you would see on the front page of the Globe, but it would, you know, it was legislation that meant a great deal to a very small group of people. And I often found that those were sort of the most rewarding experiences. And so basically with 2020, I mean, certainly we didn't know at the outset of this campaign, you know, back in December 2019, when Lou announced his retirement, We didn't know what was coming down the pike, but I felt like because I had done a pretty decent job as a staffer, I knew that I could do more as a state representative. And so I wanted that opportunity to try and do that.
And what about those people? Well, I shouldn't say those people, but what about people who feel that, you know, you've been working for Lou Kafka, and you might, you know, do the same that he was doing. I think it's a little bit unfair where people kind of cast the judgment before getting to know you. So what would you say for those who still are not sure as far as what you would bring to the community? And, you know, if they feel that you may be doing the same thing, I know we're all different. We sure. bring everything different. You know, we bring things different to the table. Yes, you've been learning from him for a long time, but what would you say to those who still are not sure that you can do a great job in your community and not what the previous representative was doing, that you would be shadowing him?
Well, and that's an awesome question, because that is sort of that was the fundamental question of my campaign, in my primary against Andrew Flowers. Who, you know, we had a very spirited debate about that, because, I get it. Working for a 30-year incumbent, it's one of those things where there is a reasonable skepticism about whether or not things will be continuing as usual, or whether or not things, you know, will shake up. My argument has always been that, you know, obviously I'm not Lou Kafka. I have my own ideas. I pride myself on the fact that I was a good staff director to Lou for many years, but you got to judge me on my record. And so, you know, the case that I've been making to voters that we were able to hammer home was, I'm asking for the job. It's a 2-year contract. You know, in 2 years, if I haven't lived up to what I tell you, what I've been telling people that I'm going to do, then you have the right to, vote me out, you know? And so that's what I'm asking is, you know, I've been asking for that chance, you know, judge me on what I'm going to be able to do and not what, you know, what Lou's done for the past, you know, 10, 15, 30 years.
Yeah. And so we're campaigning during COVID. What was your experience like? We couldn't do door knocking.
Yep.
You didn't have volunteers to knock on people's doors. What was your experience? At any point, did you feel like, oh my God, what is happening? Like, did you want to give up?
I didn't want to give up, but I will tell you that I hated campaigning during COVID-19. I mean, it's not as fun. Quite frankly, the parts of campaigning that I love, that I deeply enjoy, is the face-to-face conversations with people. And it's not just showing up on the doors and door knocking. It's, you know, it's the Stoughton days. It's the 4th of July celebrations. It's the, you know, the square jam in center of town in Sharon, or Mansfield Family Fun Day. Like those were events that I participated in for years. Those are the events that I loved. And so being part of those community events, being able to get out and shake hands and talk to people, that is, you know, that's the most enjoyable part of campaigning for me. So to have to switch it up and, you know, basically you're sticking yourself behind a computer and you know, having to do Zoom coffees and, you know, remote introductions to people, we adapt and we survive, but it wasn't as fun as it used to be. And that's, you know, it's just an unfortunate reality. And I look forward to, you know, the getting back to the day when we can campaign again in person and being able to make that personal connection, because I find so much more value in that than having to be the fourth candidate of the night calling you, you know, right around dinner time and asking. Right. It just wasn't as fun.
And what did you learn about yourself that you probably didn't know that you were capable of doing it? Or what was something that you learned about yourself that you never knew you had in yourself?
I think that I'll actually flip it a little bit, because what I'll say is that what I've learned is almost what you really come to learn what you don't know. It's the fact that, you know, despite working for this district for the last 15 years, there's still so many people that you're still introducing yourself to. So many people, you know, either, you know, through turnover in your towns, you know, people moving out and people moving in, or just people who you never had the opportunity to connect with. There's a lot of people who you don't know and you're trying to introduce yourself to. The other thing is that, you know, I learned a lot, particularly in the wake of George Floyd's murder. There was, you know, there was a reckoning across the country, and that, you know, not forced, but that was a reckoning for me too, because again, as someone who long considered himself an ally, of people of color and, you know, the Black community, you know, I had grown up in, Sharon was a Metco system.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I had great relationships, good friendships with, you know, students who were Metco students. And, you know, I'm thinking, this is great. And it's not, you know, it was one of those things where it was a real introspective point in the campaign where I was able to step back and be like, you know what, there's a lot of work that still needs to be done. And so, I learned a lot about that. I think that was the most meaningful part of the campaign for me in terms of learning about myself and what, what more I can do and how I can be a better legislator as a result of it.
Yeah. Do you feel that you're going to be working more on diversity, inclusion, starting with your community and your cabinet, and what that looks like? And, you know, what are some of the things that are dear to you, given the platform that you have, that you will make sure is a top priority so people know that you really mean business and you're talking, you talk the walk, whether you walk the talk.
There's, you know, it's one of those things where I've always been a better doer than a talker, which is actually one of the reasons why I think, you know, the campaign was so close, was that, you know, you hope that people see the work that you're doing and they mm-hmm. the work you're doing. And quite frankly, you need to speak up a little bit more about the work that you're doing during the campaign. And I needed to be better at that. But I do think that there is a lot of opportunities here moving forward. I'm very much excited to sit down with people like Representative Miranda, Representative Tyler, some of the members of Black and Latino Legislative Caucus, who I've had sort of a passing relationship to just working in the same building. But now we have an opportunity. I have an opportunity to come in, lend my voice and my vote to, you know, the legislative the Black and Latino Legislative Caucus agenda. And I think I have some decent ideas that I'm going to be proposing to them for inclusion in the agenda. Again, this is not about me leading, but this is about me using my strengths, which is I'm pretty good at getting bills passed in the legislature. So contributing those talents to the agenda so that we can make real change.
Okay. And you know, numbers don't lie. It was a tight race.
It was 350 votes.
It was a tight race, and you did a good job as well as your opponent. What went through your mind when you found out you won?
Election night was an emotional roller coaster.
It
was one of those things where, again, we talked about the four towns that are in the district, and they all came in at different times. And so the first town that came in was Stoughton, and I thought Stoughton was going to be really, really good for us. And we lost, we lost Stoughton by 100 votes. And so I was like, oh no, like this is not a good sign. We knew Walpole was going to be good for Andrew. Andrew's from Walpole. I'm from Sharon. So, you know, after the Walpole numbers came in second. And so after that, we find ourselves down 1100 votes. And I'm sitting here going, you know, this is the dream that I've worked for 15 years, and it's slipping away, and I'm losing my, you know, like, I gotta update my resume. I don't, you know, oh my God, like all these different things that run through your head.
Yeah.
Then Sharon, my hometown, comes through, and we go from down 1100 to up 404 votes. And it was like, oh my God. Now the emotional, you know, on the roller coaster, we're back up high again, and we're waiting on one precinct from Mansfield. And we knew that basically we just needed to tie in Mansfield. As long as we didn't get blown out in that one precinct, that we were, you know, that our campaign was going to be successful. And Mansfield had a problem with their printer. So it was, you know, the printer was broken or something. And so their results were being delayed. So we're waiting an hour. And then finally the numbers come in. And, you know, we got edged in Mansfield by 40, but that wasn't going to be enough. And so we knew we'd won. It was exciting and exhausting all at the same time. There were a lot of emotions. Andrew called, very gracious. You know, he on Tuesday night, he was still waiting for the numbers to come in to be final. He, you know, he asked, he basically said, I'm not going to concede, but I will, you know, we'll wait for the numbers. And I said, that's fine. You know, I totally understood. And then he graciously called on Wednesday morning to concede the race. So there was a lot of emotional downs, and it was crazy.
And then this is not your first time running either, right?
Not, no, I ran for state senate in a special election in 2017 to replace Jim Timmelty, who became the Norfolk County Treasurer. And that one was, there was no emotional roller coaster that night. When the results came in, it was very clear that it wasn't going to be our night. And, so that call was made early, and it was, obviously that was a tough feeling, but it was, there was more closure quicker.
Right. And it's important to say that, you worked hard. This is not something that you thought of, just about a year ago or 6 months ago. This is something that's been in your blood for a long time. And to finally, get the prize, I think it's important to say that you never give up. And it's important not to give up. And then that is the example for the next generation. If you have a desire in your heart, if you want to do something for your community, the passion should still be there regardless of whatever experiences or whatever you go through. Just keep on moving forward, because ultimately you will get the prize, and you're a testament of that in 2020.
I could not agree more. And I'm grateful for you saying that. I mean, and it's true. It's one of those things where if you are called to public service, don't let anyone stand in your way. And just because you don't win a race or you come up short in a race, don't let that stop you. One of the examples that I've always leaned on is, I know it was Abraham Lincoln, but I think he lost something like 7 or 8 races before he finally had success. And so it's one of those, and our greatest president ever. So, again, if you are called to public service, don't let anything stop you from participating and moving forward, because there will be, even if your opportunity is not right now, there will be opportunities in the future. And, you run positive, you run on the issues, and, you don't be negative about anything. You always leave the door open for yourself moving forward.
Absolutely. And what can we see going forward for Ted Phillips?
Well, my intention is to hit the ground running. It's one of those things where, like I said, working in the building, you get a lot of ideas. You see a lot of things that you're like, we need to fix that. We need to fix that. So I'm part of my first initiative is going to be to make some proposals to change the rules of the House and the joint rules that govern the House and the Senate in order to move some bills, in order to free up the process a little bit, make sure that bills move faster, make sure the co-sponsorships of bills, which are sort of a throwaway item right now, I want to make co-sponsorships mean something. And so, I have a couple of proposals. Actually, I've already started talking to some of the senators who I'm going to be working with, Senator Feeney, Senator Timelty, just to, hopefully lay some groundwork so that we can work together on some of those joint rule changes. So, I just want to hit the ground running, and I want to make some positive changes. We've also got a lot of bills up there, as you know, that have been stalled for years, and there's no reason. It's one of those things where if a bill hasn't been discussed or vetted or whatever, that's fine. But the fact is, these bills have been chewed over for years and years and years. It's time to start taking action and making a decision on them. Either we pass them or we don't, but let's get some action.
And what would you say are some of your platform? I know you were working on climate change, education, transportation, and I know education right now, a lot of teachers are not comfortable going into classrooms. I'm not sure what your position is on that. And, you can answer it, or if you feel that you're still working on it, it's okay. But what is your opinion right now when it comes to teachers in sharing going into classrooms?
So, as you may know, we have a big issue in sharing right now. Part of the problem is that we have the issue of whether or not to go back into classrooms, which is also overlapping with the fact that the teacher's contract is up and they're negotiating a new contract right now. And so this is, the confluence of those two events are creating a real sort of nightmare scenario that the teachers don't feel comfortable going back into the classrooms right now. And all of the reasoning from both sides, both the school committee, the administration, and the teachers, they can't talk about because they're currently bargaining, and if they talk about it, it becomes bargaining in bad faith. So, obviously, I want the teachers to feel safe going back into their classrooms. The HVAC report that the Sharon schools just had uncovered a number of problems. Hopefully, the teachers and the administration can come to an agreement in very, very short order, hopefully in the next day. which says, listen, if we fix these systems up, or we fix the issues that you have raised, they feel comfortable going back in and starting to teach, because we got to have a solution in place by the 16th, and
right.
We're running out of time.
Yes, we are. And what is your goal for the 8th Norfolk District? What do you want people to know in the 8th Norfolk District about TED, and what TED wants for them as a community? And what are you going to be fighting for the next year or so, even more, to come?
My goal is to make, the four towns in the 8th Norfolk District, sort of the best places to live in the state. I want people, when they hear Sharon, Stoughton, Walpole, Mansfield, I want them to say, that's a great place to live. I want to move there, or I'm happy moving there, and improve the quality of life for all of the residents in these four towns. For Stoughton, we've got a lot of work to do in the downtown. Obviously, we're, the good news is we're, it has been slow progress, but we are making progress. And so I'm optimistic that, during the next couple of years, we're going to be able to take control of the post office and change the layout of that, and set up what the master plan in Stoughton has called for, which is basically like a downtown quad, which will hopefully revitalize Wyman Street, bring businesses in there. We're going to take the train depot, which we finally got from MBTA control, the town control, fix that up and flip it so that, it becomes a thriving small business, whether it be restaurant or a group, mm-hmm. or, even just retail. There's a lot of potential in downtown Stoughton. One of the things that I've always told people is that if you look in the 128 belt, everything inside 128, most of those downtowns are all built out. Stoughton is the only one that still has massive amounts of potential. It can still be something because it's currently a bit of a blank canvas.
Yeah.
So, my goal is to, get to help develop those properties, bring in state resources to develop those properties and make it, all that it can be, make downtown Stoughton the destination that, quite frankly, it should be. Sharon has very different issues. Sharon's downtown is handicapped because we are at full sewer capacity in Sharon. Sharon doesn't have, I shouldn't say sewer capacity, septic capacity, excuse me, we don't have sewer in Sharon. So we're sort of, until we figure out the septic or where to get more septic capacity, we're not going to be able to further develop Sharon. But we have the Sharon Gallery, which is down by Shaw's on the Foxborough line, that is finally getting close to being developed. We have a market basket that's going to be coming in. We have a couple of other businesses that have expressed interest. Again, it's making sure that all these places get the state resources that they need. And the state works with them to make sure that we, smoothly build these out. So, in Sharon, that means, doing the traffic light and the mm-hmm. roadways for the development, things like that, that I think are going to be big for the 8th Norfolk. And then, of course, we have the larger issues to deal with. I campaigned hard on climate change. And while we passed a good bill, the House passed a good bill this session, it's still in conference committee. We got to wait and see what comes out. If anything was left on the cutting room floor, we're going to have to go back and get it next session. I think carbon pricing is going to be one of those things. We made a good step forward on environmental justice. We need to do more. So, I'm excited about getting, rolling up my sleeves and getting involved in those issues. And that's the kind of stuff that people can expect from me. They're going to be really sick of seeing me in the next 2 years, because I'm going to be just all over the place.
Yeah, thank you. And also, if you can win a primary during COVID, you can do anything you put your mind to. What advice would you have for the young people in our community about running for office or being active in a leadership role in the 8th Norfolk District?
My advice is do it. If you're thinking about running, I would tell you absolutely do it. The only caveat that I would put in is you got to do some homework beforehand. Yeah. Because, campaigns are tough things. You know what I mean? It's one of those, it requires resources. It requires mm-hmm. time. It requires people. Unfortunately, it requires money. And so I think that anybody who is serious about public service and wants to contribute, again, should absolutely do that. Your voice is badly needed in 2020. This, if Donald Trump has taught us anything, it's that if you were on the sidelines, if you were passive, that time is over. You got to get in the arena. You got to mix it up, you know, and that's why, you know, it was so important for your candidacy, you know, on the other side of Stoughton to come in and talk about these issues, because even bringing these issues brings massive, massive value to our public, you know, to our public life and to our sphere, and talking about where we want to go as, exactly, as a town, as, you know, as a state and as a country. So, you know, again, do your homework, but if you, you know, if you want to get involved, absolutely get involved. And, you know, I, one of the things that I did, I got involved with, you know, local campaigns, other, you know, state rep campaigns in the area. I would highly recommend volunteering your time. It's a great way to meet people. It's a great way to start building those networks that you can then call upon when it's your time.
Thank you so much, Ted. Again, congratulations. Thank you for what you're doing and what you will continue to do for the 8th Norfolk District. If anyone has any questions for you or they want to learn about Ted Phillips, where can they go?
Okay, so we've got the Facebook page, which is, you know, just Ted Phillips for State Representative. Very easy to find there. The website is www.tedphillips.org. And as you can see over my shoulder, Phillips only has one L. And then, you know, I'm on Twitter at Ted Phillips. And let's see, what else do I have? Oh, if you want to email me or get in touch with me, the email is tedin2020@gmail.com. And my cell phone number is 781-789-5760. I've been giving it out all the campaign, and I hope people use it. We've actually had some great people who did take us up on that opportunity to call in and ask about issues. And so, again, I'm trying to be the most available, you know, or the most accessible state representative in Massachusetts moving forward. So,
okay, thank you so much. Well done. And hope to see you soon in the future and getting to know more about you and what you're doing in the community. And good luck. Thank you so much.
I very much appreciate it. I look forward to seeing you around Stoughton, because you and I are going to work together a lot to make that town better.
Okay, I'll take you on that.
I look forward to it.
All right. Take care. Bye.